Okay, we have the last speaker, Maxwell Heger from Lille. He will talk about asymptotic behavior of the Virasoro Poisson for Planck equation. Please.
Okay, thank you very much for the introduction. So first, of course, I would like to thank the organizers for inviting me to this nice workshop. And so today, I'm going to talk about asymptotic behaviors. So you see with the plural here. Because I will be looking at large time behaviors as well as parameter limits. Okay, and it will be on the Virasoro-Poisson-Fokker-Planck equation, which I wrote on the board, and it's also on the slide here. So the Virasoro-Poisson-Fokker-Planck equation is kind of a simplified model for plasma. So the tick here is the Virasoro-Poisson-Fokker-Planck for charged particles. So it's a kinetic equation. You still have a density f depending on time, position, and velocity, which here I take position in the periodic box and velocity in R2, two-dimensional. And it satisfies this equation, which tells you that particles are transported with their own velocity in the physical space, and you have a force acting on particles, which is an electrostatic force, okay? So it's minus the gradient of the potential. This potential itself is satisfying a Poisson equation, where in the source you have rho, which is the macroscopic density of F. So it makes the system nonlinear. And here you have a rho star, and so rho star should be thought of as a fixed density of background particles with opposite charge. Okay, so you can think of this as electrons, and you have a background of ion, which is not moving because electrons are faster and basically, so yes, so you have two parameters in the equation, you see, tau and delta. So they have physical meaning. Tau would be the scale mean free pass, so the scale mean free pass, and delta would be the scale dominance. So for me, mathematically, they will measure either the strength of collisions or the strength of the nonlinearity. So you see that if tau is very small, you have very strong collisions with the Fokker-Planck operator here, which I didn't talk about, but is a kind of simplified model of the Landau operator. That's why we use this, this equation. And if tau is large, you have vanishing collisions, and you go to Virasoro-Poisson, formally. And if delta is small, then you have a strong nonlinearity. And if delta is large, you have a weak nonlinearity. So we are looking at large-time behavior mainly. So you first wonder what are the steady state of this equation. So you look at the steady problem, it's here. Basically, you have the argument saying that in the appropriate functional space, which is L2 with the weight, which is the inverse of this thing here, this operator is symmetric and this one is Q-symmetric. So for this equation to be true, you should have both side vanishing. This side vanishes if you are Maxwellian, okay? So centered Maxwellian here, local equilibrium. And if you plug the Maxwellian into the transport part here, you find that rho should be a Gibbs measure here, exponential minus phi. Then you wonder what is the static potential. So you plug the this in the Poisson equation, and you find that, well, the potential should satisfy a Poisson-Boltzmann equation written here. Okay. So the large-time behavior of this system has been studied first by Boucher and Dolbo, where they proved that the solution should, I mean, it's not exactly the same setting, it's on the whole space and there is no other species, and but anyway, you should converge in the large towards the steady state, without any rate. There, more recently, you have a paper who showed exponentially fast return to equilibrium in a perturbative setting, either when you are close to the initial data or when you have some parameter like us, which is such that the nonlinearity is small. Okay, this is the case in Aero, the work of Aero and Thomas. Here we have this measure of the collisions, and we would like to derive quantitative long-time estimates that are uniform in the regimes where tau is either small or in the regime where tau is large. And understand how the rate of decay depends on tau. Okay? And why do we do that? We hope that if we get some uniformity, we might use the estimates, the proving long-time behavior to also derive asymptotic models, such as the models you obtain in the diffusion limit of the equation. So I will come back on this. So the main tool for proving the long-time estimates are hypocoercivity estimates, which I will recall here on a simple model, and then we'll try to model this on a Blasopoulos Fokker-Planck. So this model is the kinetic Fokker-Planck equation. It's kind of the same, so except that here I'm in 1D, and I don't have an electric field. Okay, the equation is linear. And so, what I would like to show is that f goes to the Gaussian. Okay. Okay. So what I do is that I introduce a perturbative unknown h, which is f minus l, and I divide by the Maxwellian. And I would like to show that h goes to zero in some norms which are related to this weighted L2 space, which are where the weight is the Maxwellian. Okay. So, what is the difficulty in all this? The difficulty is that basically you have a dissipation phenomenon in the velocity variable. So you expect to go to equilibrium in the velocity variable, but you don't. It's not obvious that you have dissipation in the space variable. Okay, but you would like to show that the solution goes to global equilibrium in x and v. Actually, what happens is that you have this transport term here, doing some mixing in the phase space, and dissipation in the velocity variable transfers to the position variable. So you can see that by this kind of estimate. So if you estimate the L2 norm, weighted L2 norm, you see that it is dissipated, so okay. It decays, you don't know how fast yet. And you would know how fast if you could control the norm by the dissipation. You cannot do this here because you only have derivative in velocity, you would like derivative in space. So you say, okay, maybe I should try to estimate derivatives. You do this, you have these estimates. And here it's even worse because you see that when you derive this estimate here, you have to differentiate the equation, and dV does not commute with the transport operator. In the end, what you find is an additional remainder term here, that you cannot control by a linear combination of the three estimates here, of the three dissipations, because still you don't have dxh in the dissipation. But now you say, okay, actually it doesn't commute, so I'm going to use that, and I try to take the time derivative of the product here, dxdv, and now I create the dissipation dxh for the same reason, plus remainder terms that I can control with all the dissipation. Okay. So basically, you introduce a functional, okay? So this technique was introduced by Hero and Nir. It was also used on different on Boltzmann models by Mu and Neumann, developed in a more abstract way by Villani. And there were also previous uses of anisotropic norms by Denis Talley and Yann Guo. Not exactly this, but okay. Also anisotropic norms. Okay, so you introduce this functional here, okay, you do a linear combination, you have the associated dissipation, and I claim that you can choose the constant so that this is equivalent to the H1 norm, and it dissipates. Okay. Then you can use the Poincaré inequality because A basically D controls E, okay, you have in D, you have the derivative in V and in X, and by your Poincaré inequality, you can control H by these two derivatives. You get exponential decay in the end. Okay, now we want to do this for Vlasov-Poisson-Fokker-Planck. And of course, the challenges will be that now we are looking at a nonlinear equation. We have this inhomogeneity in the background, which will bring some annoying terms, and we especially want uniformity in. Parameters, so when you have strong collisions or weak collisions. Donc, so, I first show you the theorem, and then I will comment on the result and show you the proof. Okay. A sketch of the proof. So basically, in the case of strong collisions, okay, so tau is small here. Tau is small. So we start from a background with some regularity. You see that obviously this hides some injection into L infinity, or okay. Basically, the result says that we can choose a tau zero, which is the maximum size of tau, and R zero, which will be the maximum size of the initial data. And then there is a parameter uniformly for tau small, smaller than tau zero, and uniformly for delta large, larger than some constant which depends on R zero, and uniformly for initial data smaller than R zero. There is a unique solution, it satisfies this exponential decay estimate. Okay? And you observe that in the exponential decay estimate, here you have the dependence in tau. In particular, when tau goes to zero, it vanishes. Okay? The rate vanishes. And you also have continuity with respect to the initial data. Okay, so I show you the theorem in the evanescent collision case. Okay? So it's kind of the same, except now we are looking at large tau, and the bound on delta is a bit different. Previously, we had a uniform bound on delta which was uniform in tau. Here, it depends on the positive power of tau. And the exponential decay is now 1 over tau, depends on 1 over tau. So it also vanishes when tau goes to infinity. This time. Okay. So let me comment on these rates. So first, the decay rates. So you have tau when tau goes to zero, and 1 over tau when tau goes to infinity. So you may wonder, is it some special feature of Lazard-Poisson-Kruger-Planck? Or actually, not, it's not at all. It is expected from the hypocoercive structure of the equation, even at the linear level. Basically, if you do a very, if you look at this very silly, silly model here, this is basically hypocoercive, okay, because you have some dissipation here, but in only one variable, okay, only the second variable, and you, here you have mixing, okay, and well, you know that if you compute the solutions to this equation, it will be a decaying exponential times the cosines or sines, well, it will go to zero, okay, but you don't see dissipation everywhere right now. Well, of course, you can compute the endgame values of the matrix, so summing this matrix with this matrix times 1 over tau, okay? And you plot the real part of the endgame values, and basically you have two endgame values when tau is small, and only two real endgame values when tau is small, two complex when tau is large, and you can verify that the spectral gap is like tau when tau is small, and like 1 over tau when tau is large, okay? So basically, these rates were expected in some sense. So I think it's interesting in the sense that you could think that the more collisions you put, the faster you will go to global equilibrium. But actually, it is not true. You need really a balance between collision and transform.
Can you go back to the next slide? Next slide, please.
Yes.
So your initial data only depends on R0, not depends on tau, right?
No, it doesn't. No, it does not depend on tau.
Okay.
I mean, probably if you could make it depend on tau as soon as you have uniformity of this bound. Okay, so now on the size of the nonlinearity, so the size of the nonlinearity is measured with this parameter delta, which when it's large, it means that the nonlinearity is small. So the condition we get for strong collisions when tau goes to zero is that delta should be greater than some constant, which depends on the maximal size of the initial data, but which does not depend on tau. It turns out in the analysis that it is this condition is the same for the linearized equation for with our technique, I mean, and so it does not confirm nonlinear effect. And anyway, this uniformity in tau is good because we can use this estimate to pass to the limit in tau on appropriate time scales. We need to rescale in time and then pass to the limit, and derive asymptotic models from our hypocoercivity estimates. Now, in the case of evanescent collisions, you have this ray delta greater than the power of tau. So when tau goes to infinity, basically it tells you that delta should go to infinity too, so no nonlinearity. Okay? So clearly you cannot pass to the limit and get Vlasov-Poisson. Okay? I mean the nonlinearity will disappear. So and here the fact that this is this power and everything, it really comes from nonlinear terms in the estimate. So we can ask whether we could get uniformity in tau or not. And I claim that you could not get uniformity in tau, because if you had uniformity in tau, that would mean that you could take limits at least formally and get Vlasov-Poisson. And our result would tell you that any initial data is stable for Vlasov-Poisson, because here I show estimates in L2 norm, but actually we obtain much more than this. We control also derivatives and everything. Everyone should decay. And it is known that for Vlasov-Poisson, if you take special initial data, which are a double Hund equilibrium, for instance, so stuff like this in velocity, something like this, this is unstable. You couldn't get an estimate like this. Okay. And now, why this weird 7 to the 15th here? Okay, we don't claim that it is optimal. It's certainly not optimal. But we can ask what is the worst we could expect. So basically, we have an equation which returns to equilibrium with a rate which is 1 over tau here. Okay, even at the linear level. So I build a toy model where you have this exponential decay, and I add a nonlinear term, which looks like, which has some kind of the same structure as the Poisson term here, in the sense that it is quadratic, you have the 1 plus for the inhomogeneity, and you have the 1 over delta squared, which would appear in the equation. Okay, it's here that you could put psi equal delta squared phi, and recover the 1 over delta squared here. Okay? Well, and you see that on this example, you will have exponential decay if delta is greater than to the square root of tau. So basically, we gain something. So we gain something from the Poisson structure, but okay, is it optimal? I don't know. Okay, so now I show you the sketch of the proof in the case of a small parameter tau. Okay. So we start kind of like for the kinetic Fokker-Planck equation. We rewrite the equation thanks to the perturbative unknown, okay, H. The difference now is that the steady state F infinity depends on X and B, okay. And we also introduce a perturb potential, psi, which is the difference between phi and phi at equilibrium, okay. So you put this into the Vlasov Poisson Fokker Planck equation, and what I do find is this. Okay, so basically on the left hand side it's the kinetic or Vlasov Fokker Planck part, and on the right hand side you have terms depending on the self consistent electric field. Okay, you have two types of terms. This one is linear. Okay, it comes from the fact that when you plug the perturbative unknown here, at some point, we have F infinity, we take the derivative of the Maxwellian, and it will be V times times E. And of course, you still have a nonlinear term, which is here. The Poisson equation, so you subtract the Poisson equation at time t and the steady one, so the background disappears in some sense, and you have a Poisson equation where psi is given in terms of H. Okay, so E, the electric field is minus tabla psi. Okay, so what we are going to do is to do a fixed point argument to close the estimates. Sorry. So basically, we are going to build some functional, which is an hypocoercive functional, which I'm going to show in a second. And we are going to do a banner fixed point argument in the space where this functional is bounded. Okay, bounded by some constant r, which is twice r0, which was the maximal size of the initial data. We need some room for nonlinear effects. We will have some nonlinear growth at some point. Okay, and we want to prove exponential decay, so we even want the application to go into a smaller space where you have bounds on the entropy in some sense and on the dissipation, so that you can get exponential decay. Okay, and so the fixed point argument is done by replacing this E of H here by a E of G, where G is taken in XR, and we want to show that this maps to H in YR, and then then you and have contraction and then close everything. Okay, so now here is the functional that we introduce. So basically, we are going to estimate this. Okay, all the work is estimating this. And the functional is the sum of a twisted norm, twisted hypocoercive norm, and some other term here. I will not comment much on this. Actually, okay, it's kind of a good term. It adds to the entropy. So the interesting one is this one. So you see, it still have the same structure than in the kinetic Fokker-Planck case. You have H, nabla V, nabla X, and the cross term. And the Hilbertian setting is a bit different since the equilibrium has changed. But anyway, the main difference is that you have some weights in the Lyapunov function. Okay, you have two types of weights. The first type is weights in time here. So these weights in time are there to quantify regularization effects. You see that if you take t equals zero, you kill all these terms, the three last terms. So basically, you can start from data which has only this bounded, only the L2 norm. And if you can bound this thing, it tells you that actually the derivative are also bounded by some constant decaying in time. And more importantly, now we have the weights in time, it's not our idea, it's a technique that was introduced by Hugo and Mir to quantify this hypoelliptic regularization effect. The weights in tau here that we added is to get the uniformity in both regions. So we have introduced parameters in tau to the some power, beta 1, beta 2, beta 3, and we try to choose beta 1, beta 2, beta 3 to close the estimates and get the best exponential decay possible. Okay. So the associated dissipation still looks like the case of kinetic Fokker-Planck. So you have the various dissipations, and weights. We will use to get in the end the exponential convergence to zero. We will use a Poincaré inequality. Since the equilibrium is not just the Gaussian, we will need to bound exponential. The x part of the equilibrium. Okay, exponential phi, exponential minus. Minus 5. So in this bound, you will appear the dependence of the background density, because this satisfies the Poisson-Boltzmann equation where you have the background. Okay. And for the same reason, you expect to be, as in the kinetic Fokker-Planck, you expect to get this inequality, except that you will have some power of tau, and this beta star here will try to optimize it to get the best decay. Okay, so in order to close the estimates, I don't show you all the remainder terms and everything, but basically when you do the computation, so you derive the entropy, you get some dissipation, which I wrote just before, and a bunch of linear of remainder terms here, which are of four types. Okay. So the first type, one here, is basically the remainder terms you would get with kinetic Fokker-Planck already. Okay. So these guys, you want to choose the constants and the weights so that you can eat it with the dissipation here. it imposes, so in order to have uniformity when tau goes to zero, it imposes constraints on the power beta. Okay, and I wrote these constraints here. Okay, basically, to observe every term, you need the set of beta to be like this. Okay, so at this level, if you forget about the other remainder terms, you say, okay, I'm done. You get already the optimal decay rate. You cannot obtain better than the decay exponential minus tau t. Okay. And it imposes a unique choice of beta in this case. In the case of evanescent collisions, it's a bit more tricky. Okay, then you have other terms. So these guys here, they depend on delta. So it means that they are related with the electric field. Okay, this it comes from the linear term where they're depending on the electric field. So if I show you again the equation, it's this guy here. The remainder 2 is this guy, and 3 and 4 are these guys. Okay? So basically, these two, there is no problem. You can observe them as long as you choose delta large enough. Okay? And the last term is a bit tricky. It's a term typically where you have to bound the L infinity norm of the electrostatic field. And it turns out that to do this by the regularity given by the Poisson equation and Sobolev injection, you need some derivative in x of h, which you don't have at the beginning. Okay, but you know it decays. I mean, you don't have it at the beginning, but you gain it, and you know how you gain it because you have these weights in the here. Okay, you know that this should decay like 1 over t to the So basically, bounding this estimate, you get something like this. Okay, here for delta square, delta large enough, you can hit these guys by the dissipation. Here I already absorbed one because of this theta here, which is less than one. And this last term here, it will give you a contribution like this, okay, where you can close because this function here is integrable at zero because by Sobolev injection here, you need only eta to be positive. It can be as small as you want, so you can take it small enough, less than one third, so that this is integrable. Okay, basically. Okay, so that's how you close the estimate, and then it gives you existence, exponential decay, and everything. So I will finish on the drift convergence to the drift diffusion system. I will not say much about it, just that with all the estimates we get from the previous computation, we can now rescale the equation in time, like this. Okay. So now you have a tau here, okay, and the same for the potential, of course. And it is known that when tau goes to zero, this should converge to a local Maxwellian where the macroscopic density satisfies this equation called drift diffusion system. So actually, with our estimate, we can prove that this rigorously, with strong convergence on rho in this space. I mean, on F in this space. Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't give any more details because it's the end. Just a conclusion. So we proved the large chain behavior thanks to hypocoercivity method that we managed to adapt in the nonlinear setting, even if it's weakly nonlinear, because we have a condition on delta here, which tells us that the nonlinearity should not be too bad. We get uniformity in tau, which allows us to get to justify asymptotic models. So some perspective would be an extension to the 3D case. So the main difference in the 3D case is that in this last part, where you need to control E in L infinity, now the Sobolev injection is not the same, okay? You need eta to be larger than this, okay? So in dimension 2, it's eta positive. In dimension 3, it's eta better larger than 1 half. And if you go back here, you see that if you put 1 half, okay, it's not integrable anymore. So basically, you cannot close the estimate the same way. But what you can do is go to higher order derivatives. So you add second order derivatives in your functional, and you will still need just a fraction of them to close the argument. And maybe a more interesting perspective would be to try this and replacing LT norms by some kind of free energy here, which is the natural estimate for this equation. Okay, so you have a natural a priori estimate for Poisson-Fokker-Planck, which is this one. Mm-hmm. And if we could adapt to the with the free energy, it would be great because we might drop the constraints on delta, maybe, or at least in the regime close to zero. And there has been some work on hypercoercivity using, let's say, entropy rather than L2 norms by Unani, by Josephine, by Dolbo and Lee more recently. Okay, and thank you very much for your attention.
Any questions?
Arnold, Schmeissel, well, they were doing the Lobsol of inequalities and so on. And so I'm not sure what I'm missing because I do remember the coupling with Poisson, but disregard my comment if you don't. Sorry, it would be more informed. And then I have another question, which is could you, you talk about the decay rate for the evanescent solutions, which is to do the tau that is going to make the collisions go away and somehow. That is very related to, for instance, scaling limits that you should get for Coulomb potentials when you do grazing collision limits. And have you looked into that?
Okay.
You know, it's very interesting because, for instance, you have the work of Guo and the strain, which they do for the linearized equation, around the Landau of the the nonlinear Landau for Coulomb potential, they get this decay rate, which is e to the minus t to the 2/3, which basically is a signature, in my view, of evanescence potential, in the sense that you don't have a spectrum gap, it's that you decay much slower. And somehow, in your calculation, a little bit that flavor comes into it.
Okay, so clearly the evanescent generally is the physically most interesting. The right model for plasma would be to put a Landau with this evanescent collisions. And on the okay, I don't know, but here so it decays less and less when it goes to infinity, and indeed, I have seen some papers, also not the one that you are mentioning, but one by Badrosian also, who is looking back at this equation, but even a more complicated version where you have nonlinear Fokker-Planck, which is not Landau, but which has the same invariant. And they seem to get a different rate here, which is, to 1/3 or 2/3.
Right, so it changes the exponent in time somehow. Here is to the double spectrum, probably the double t.
Oh, it's
so a this is something, I don't know the one of Redder's, but I know the Guo strain is, it would be an exponential with t, so it's e to the minus factor t to the two-thirds.
Okay.
So here is stronger because you have T. And I'm not sure, because it's linear, because you are not, because you are taking the Fokker plot, and it's a linear diffusion. Mm-hmm. And when you look at the Strauss-Landau corrections, it's the, you would have a kind of stronger non-linearity. So it's no local, but you have a thing, it's a divergence of something much more singular than that. But
okay, to be honest, I don't know what you will get with that. I have no intention I understand what you mean.
Because he considers more or less that the Gaussian operator is a linear operator. But if you replace by lambda wave, it should be big problem because initial lambda wave depends on the coefficient in front of that.
No, that is absolutely. But if you look at the linearized argument of Hoare, you still get.
The
Coulomb, so it's like it would be.
Yeah.
The diffusive term a little bit more.
Because now he puts some scaling parameter in front of the
constant diffusion here.
He considers the initial data is independent of that parameter.
Oh, maybe.
If you apply the Bob stress theory, you will find that actually the initial will depend on the parameter tau minus 1. Then when tau minus 1 goes, tau goes sleeping, you can see.
No, but when you linearize Landau, the kernel remains singular.
Yeah.
So which means it's the diffusion multiplied by a singular function. That would be the difference.
Yeah.
And that is interesting because you may be able to push that argument.
So in some sense, you have less coercivity than in the case of
exactly.
The singularity.
Right, and that in your ODE has to come slightly different than nonlinearity to pick up that, but it's maybe you can do it because it's a new the question actually for plasmas of having the true Landau equation even in the linear setting as you go closer because you have fourth dimensional field because you have a closed system right into periodic boundary conditions with the plasma equation that probably should give you. You should get probably the same decay of Hoare. That's what I'm
looking for.
It's something like that. Or at least exponent. Maybe the evanescence is the rate on which the exponent decay. But that would be a super interesting question.
Okay, thank you for the remark.
Maybe another remark, but more speculative, perhaps. So if you take the Vlasov equation, Vlasov Poisson, and if you look at the Poisson-Boucher limit, right? So then in that case, you obtain what Poignier calls the kinetic order equation. And so now, what you're doing here is that you're looking at the long-time behavior, and in the case where you add a Fokker plot term on the right-hand side. So do you suppose when you let t go to infinity? And also remove the Fokker plot and go to the Poisson-Boucher limit. So, of course, if everything was uniform, this would shed some light on the problem of the limit of Euler in the long time. So you expect somehow what you observe here could have something to do with some, could provide some hints as to what the asymptotic behavior of solutions to the Euler equation might be.
So you're saying basically you look at this equation and you put zero here, so this is a pressure some kind. And
So then the potential the phi plays the role of the pressure.
Mm-hmm.
It's associated to the constraint. I think you want something. You need to take rho not equal to one. So the torus. That's okay.
So this is the kinetic version, and so that often people consider also monokinetic initial data.
Of course. So if you take f to be a Dirac measure of v equals,
you recover
then immediately u is going to be divergent string because you have rho equals one, and not only that, but it satisfies Euler, and the grad phi is going to be the phi is going to be the pressure.
Okay. But mixed with the Fokker-Planck equation.
Yeah, of course, if you have the Fokker-Planck equation, then you lose the monocle.
Yeah.
You have the thickening of the Dirac measure. So I was wondering whether this, nevertheless, could provide some information as to the long time unit or if you expect anything like that.
Honestly, I have to look at it. I don't know.
Okay, if there is no other question, let's ask.